Dear students, welcome back. In this session, we are going to discuss about the actions of lumbricals. The lumbricals are the only muscles in the body that attach the tendons of other muscles, both proximally and distally. So we have seen the attachments in the earlier session. So these four lumbricals are arising from the tendons of the FDP, that is flexor digitorum profundus. Okay, so each muscle arises from the tendon of the FDP in the palm, which passes olarly to the transverse metacarpal ligament and attaches to the lateral band of the extensor mechanism on the radial side. So here it is attached on the radial side of the extensor mechanism. Okay. So like the interossei, these lumbricals also cross the MCP joint olarly and IP joints dorsally. Okay. So differences in functions in the two muscle groups can be attributed to the lumbricals. More distal insertion on the lateral band to the profundus tendon origin and to their great contractile range. Okay, so now we will see how the function is taking place because of its attachments to the distal end as well as the proximal end and also its contractile range. Okay, yes, the insertion of the lumbricals on the distal lateral bands make them consistently effective IP extensors, so interphalangeal extensors, regardless of MCP position, whether it may be whatever it may be in the position. Okay, whether it may be in extension or in flexion, so the lumbricals is effective interphalangeal extensors. Okay, in MCP extension, the transverse metacarpal ligament prevents the lumbrical muscle from migrating dorsally, and losing tension as the IP joints extend. Okay, so here also this transverse metacarpal ligament helps the lumbrical muscle from migrating dorsally, so and losing tension as the IP joints extend. Okay, some of the studies have found that the lumbricals to be more frequently active as IP extensors in the MCP extended position than the interossei. When the lumbrical contracts, it pulls not only on the distal insertion but also on its proximal origin. Here you can see here, so during the contraction of the lumbrical muscle, it not only having an action at the distal end but also it is having action at the proximal end also. So this lumbrical is attaching here on the radial side. Okay, so here it is acting on the extensor mechanism distally, and proximally it is also pulling the flexor digitorum profundus. Okay, it also having some action, it also pulling the profundus tendon distally, so it is pulling the tendon distally. Okay, whereas proximally it is pulling this extensor mechanism proximally. Okay, so this is the thing happening. So the distal movement of the FDP tendon, so what will happen, the distal movement of the FDP tendon releases much of the flexor force of the profundus at the MCP joint as well as the IP joints. So, if the passive flexor force is released, while and also this lumbricals will have an active IP extensor force. So, because of this release of this flexor digitorum profundus tendon helps in the extension of the IP joints. Okay, so normally this is the passive force which is obstructing the extension, isn't it? So, because of the pull of the lumbricals, what is happening? The movement of the flexor digitorum profundus tendon distally releases the tension in the FDP joint, FDP tendon, which helps in the extension of the IP joint. So, once this FDP tendon is released here, okay, so when the contraction is taking place here, what will happen? So, the flexion at the interphalangeal joints, IP joints, is not taking place and it causes extension. Okay, so this is the thing happening here. And some of the studies that Rani and Wells confirmed this, finding that the interphalangeal joints did not extend until the tension within the lumbricals or equal the tension within the profundus. Okay, which permitted the lumbricle to pull the profundus tendon distally. Okay, if you see in the NCP flexion, the large contractile range of the lumbrical muscles allow them to shorten sufficiently to produce both MCP flexion and IP extension simultaneously. So, if you see this flexion, MCP flexion, so what will happen? The lumbricals. So, the contractile range is going to increase. So, if you see in this, the contractile range is like this. During flexion, the contractile range is more. So, the more contractile range helps the lumbrical muscles to produce both MCP flexion as well as IP extension simultaneously. Okay, the distal introche can also extend the IP joints. However, they are less effective as IP extensors in the absence of lumbricals. Okay, so the lumbricals have a greater moment arm for MCP flexion. If you can see, so the distance between the action line and the MCP joint, so the moment arm is more, so it is having greater moment arm for MCP flexion than the introche, since the lumbricals lie older to the introche. Functionally, however, this component of lumbrical action is relatively weak. Okay, why? Because the cross-sectional area of the lumbricals is small when compared to the introche. And also the moving origin of lumbricals on the profundus. So these two things causes some relative weakness of this MCP flexion when compared to the introche. Okay, so although the lumbricals cross the MCP joint, a contraction of the lumbricals causes the FDP tendon and the origin of the lumbrical muscles to glide distally. While enhancing the function of IP extension, the same movement minimizes the active force of the lumbrical at the MCP joint. Okay. So as a whole, we can see that the function of the lumbricals is simpler than that of the introche. The lumbricals are strong extensors of the IP joint, regardless of the MCP joint position, and they are also relatively weak MCP flexors, regardless of MCP joint position. The ability of the lumbricals to extend the IP appears to be dependent only on the intact tension in the extensor mechanism and in the FDP tendons. So this is about the actions of the lumbricals. In the next session, we are going to see the structure of the thumb and its joints and its musculature in the next session. Thank you.